Hi everyone, and welcome back to Lesson 2 of Spreadsheets for Business. In this second and final video of Level 1, we'll 1. Learn how to manage large worksheets by freezing rows and columns, along with splitting the window, and 2. We'll also calculate some basic statistics such as mean, median, mode, and standard deviation for our business case that we started in the previous video. If you recall, we now have two correct and consistent columns of friction coefficient and torsion strength data here in columns F and G. The main purpose in doing this was so that we could determine statistically whether or not the last 7 days of production testing data was statistically better or worse than our historical production data. This will help us to determine the best course of action in expanding our business. This brings us to the heart of this lesson in the basic statistical functions used to determine the mean, median, mode, and standard deviation. I'm not going to define each of them beyond their basic definitions, as that's beyond the scope of this course, but the textbook that goes along with the course does a pretty good job of describing them in detail, so please go there for a further description. In this video, I just want to show you how to use the functions that calculate these values. With data in this data set, we have the frictional coefficients and torsion strength of 29 ski boards that we manufactured this last week. At the very bottom of this table, I want to do some statistical calculations on these numbers, but I don't want to keep scrolling back and forth, up and down all the time. I want to be able to see the top and the bottom of the page at the same time. I can just adjust the zoom of the page over here in the lower right-hand corner. But now the numbers get so small I can't see them any longer. Rather than do that, Excel's provided me some other options. The first option is referred to as freezing or freezing a pane. If you go up to the home ribbon and then select the View tab, you see some zooming tools here, and they're occasionally useful depending on how the data in your worksheet is laid out. But let's click on the pull down here under Freeze Panes. You can now freeze the first row here. And let's see what that does and how we can interact with our sheet. See the faint line between the first and the second row? This is how Excel shows you that a freeze is currently in place. You see how the title in the first row is now visible regardless of how far I scroll down the page? Neat, but not terribly useful since the top row is just a header and not the column header information that's most useful to me when I'm working or looking down here. The freeze first column does basically the same thing, except it freezes the first column in place and allows you to scroll over to the right without losing sight of the data in that first column. The third option is to pick a place on the page that you want to freeze above or below or to the left or the right and click on that cell, row, or column. For instance, if I click here on cell B3, and select Freeze Panes, everything above and to the left of this cell is frozen in place, allowing for scrolling all over the place while keeping our row and column headers in place. Let me undo that by clicking Unfreeze Panes. Another useful and sometimes more functional way of doing something similar is referred to as splitting the screen. Sometimes you want the screen split in half vertically, horizontally, or maybe even both. You do this by selecting the row or the column or the cell on the screen where you want the split to appear and then clicking on the split icon here in the View tab. Now you see a heavier border where this page is now split. This split screen allows you the ability to work up here, anywhere on the screen, while the bottom half stays in place, or vice versa. It allows you to drag the split or partition around to suit your needs if they change without having to unfreeze and refreeze your panes in freeze mode. Also, to delete this split, all you have to do is double click on it and it disappears. For this case, I want to freeze the top two rows in place, so I'll be able to simultaneously see both of those top two rows and the summary info at the bottom. So I'll select the third row and select Freeze Panes. Now I'm good to continue. Here in the statistical summary area of the page, the first three analyses, mean, median, and mode, are just three statistical formulas that are sometimes capable of generally describing a large chunk of data by summarizing it into one number. In Excel, the mean is calculated by using the average function. We're going to use the average function to determine the average of all these friction coefficients from row 3 down to row 31. So let me go here and type in equals average, left parentheses, F3 colon F31, and run the formula by hitting enter. This is the average for all of these friction coefficients. Let me drag this to the right to determine the average value of all these torsion strengths while I'm here. Now let's do the median. The median value is the middle value of all the values, so if you sorted all of them, the median value would be right smack in the middle with an equal number of rows above it and below it. To calculate the median, start your formula with equals median and then highlight all of the cells from F3 to F31. This median is very close to the average, so that indicates a reasonably normal distribution from a statistics point of view, but again, I wander off track. That's not really important now. Let me drag this across as well to determine the median for the torsion strengths while I'm here. Moving on to mode. Move to this cell and type equals mode dot SNGL, or single, parentheses, F1 colon F33, and enter. The mode is the most commonly occurring value in a range of cells. If there is a tie in the most commonly occurring value, the mode.single formula will bring back just the first one that it runs into. For example, if we come over here and put in some numbers for a minute, just to play with, 1, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 6. You'll see that the 3 is in here twice and the 4 is in here twice. So there's two modes. If we put the mode single formula right here and hit enter, the formula returns the mode of 3. Getting back to our case, let me delete this little experiment and move back over here. To save me a little time, I'm going to drag this median formula down, but I see that due to the relative referencing, all of my row numbers got incremented by 1, so I'm going to make these rows stay in place by using the dollar sign and making these mixed references. Now I drag this down and replace the median function with the mode.single and enter. And then I can drag this formula across and down in preparation for working on the standard deviation function. The final statistical function that we're going to work with in this chapter is the standard deviation. This is a measure of how far or spread out the data is from the average of that data. A small standard deviation means that your values are very near each other or packed together around your average. A large standard deviation means that your data is more scattered. Here, our average is 0.76. Let's go down here and figure out our standard deviation. Equals STDEV dot S, where the S stands for sample, and hit enter. With a standard deviation of 0.26, that, in a perfect world, means that approximately 70% of our data would reside within plus or minus one standard deviation of the mean, or 0.5 to 1.02. If you care, another rule of thumb is that 95% of your data is within plus or minus two standard deviations of the means, but I digress. Let's get back on track. Let me complete this part of the case by dragging the standard deviation formula across like so. Now that we have these figures, we can compare them to the same information that we have from our historical data about the ski boards that we've previously manufactured. This data is contained on the second worksheet here called Comparison. See here that we have this historical data listed for both the friction coefficient as well as the torsion strength. We now need to populate these values in the current column. We could type in or copy the values from the previous page, but it's always a better practice to have these cells refer to these cells over here so that if the data over here changes, it doesn't break our analysis by going out of sync with our actual data. So let's go up here to this cell and start typing in our formula the hard way just for practice. Equals, single quote, current, which is the name of the other sheet, single quote, exclamation point, and then our cell reference of F33. That's the current mean. Since we had the forethought to have all of the data on the previous page be in the exact same order as this page, we can exploit Excel's use of relative referencing to be able to just copy these cells and these formulas from here down to here. Now we'll do the same for the torsion strength, but instead of writing it out, I'll use my mouse to select the proper cell. Equals, this page, this cell, and then enter. Now highlight these cells and hit Control D for down. Let's now calculate the difference to gain some insight on how different the new data is to the historical data. Go here, equals C4 minus B4. We have a negative difference here, so the current friction coefficient is a little better than it used to be, which is a good thing. How much different? Let's calculate this as a percentage in this column by using this formula. We take the difference of the current minus the historical and then divide it by the historical. Notice that we have to include brackets around the difference part here, or else we would come out with the wrong answer. As we can now see, the difference in means has decreased by 0.41%, which means they're even slicker than they were before. Cool, let's go faster down that hill. Let's copy the formula down to see what else we can surmise. The median has increased, but since there are only 29 data points, having the middle point of the sorted data just change by one row in one place in that stack of sorted values, this would cause the jump of this magnitude, so I'm willing to accept this. The mode is just the most commonly occurring value, so in this data, that doesn't mean much. The standard deviation has dropped about 3%, which means that our new data is closer to the mean than the historical data, so in essence, it's more consistent. Now for the torsion strength. I can either retype all of these formulas, or I can notice that these formulas that we created over here in the friction coefficient line up from a cell reference standpoint with these over here in the torsion strength. Relative referencing is now on our side here since the formula's references will be the same. So I can just copy these formulas over into these empty cells, and I think we're good. Since this is such an important decision, I'll double check my logic on these cells by looking at the cell precedence lines up here in the formula bar. These all look good and consistent with what I want, so let's take a look at the results for the torsion strength. See here that the torsion strength has decreased by 3.6%, and that's not good. Stronger is better. The median dropped by a little, and the mode rose by 4+%. We also see that the standard deviation rose by 2.29%, so this means that we're producing skis with less torsion strength and not as consistently as before. This could be due to just one ski board that was really crappy off the assembly line, but you should go back to the data to confirm or disprove this theory. Either way, our production is not as consistent as it used to be, and this would cause me to want to research this issue before I ramped up production, since this could evolve into a serious customer service nightmare, a recall, or dreaded Twitter hashtag of hashtag TZ Edge sucks. So we don't want that, do we? That's it for level 1. So we're now ready to go on to the next level in this lesson.